Sports Radio 66, my son.
The Fan.
W-F-A-N.
Sports Radio 66.
The Fan.
All right, let's go right to Madison Square Garden. Our very own Outside the Cage podcast team of Pete Hoffman and Ike Feldman.
Madison Square Garden in New York City gets the fastest rising sport probably in the world.
If you like chaos,
you got it.
You certainly got it.
Championship belts in two weight classes at the same time.
I love New York.
We'll do everything that we said we would do when we got to New York.
Looking for that knockout punch. And boom.
This is Cowboy, and you're listening to WFAN Outside the Cage podcast.
This is WFAN's Outside the Cage with your host, Pete Hoffman, Ike Feldman. Check us out at underscore outside the cage, at Ike underscore CBS.
At the Hoff WFAN. What up?
Check us out YouTube, WFAN.com, play.it, iTunes, maybe CBSSports.com. All these places. Just started out real quick because I like to preview who we're going to have on in studio.
Who?
Oh, my gosh, dude. I barely can fit through the door.
Small guy?
It's very, very tiny guy. Very tiny guy. Number six ranked heavyweight in the UFC, Francis Ngannou. Guy is amazingly sweet, first of all. Very soft-spoken guy, but awesome. Great guest in studio. He tells us who he wants next. And which is, I'm ready for that fight. So Francis Ngannou's up first. He's about 6-7 minutes away. If you want to fast forward and not hear us talk, you can go to that. Go check it out on YouTube.com, our interview with him and Francis Ngannou. He is Francis Ngannou, and we're interviewing him.
No, he could interview us.
He could.
I'll answer whatever he says. I'll do whatever he wants.
Yeah,
he's a big mother.
You want to take a punch? I can't. But we'll get to that later. So after Francis, we have Bellator's own Jimmy Smith. He does commentary for him.
Another bald color commentator.
Yeah, who did it first, Rogan or him? I don't know. but we'll dive into that too with Jimmy. Jimmy gives a lot about Fight Quest and a bunch of stuff.
A lot.
So yeah, he was great. Thanks so much for Jimmy joining us. That's after Francis Ngannou, and then after that, you don't think it can get any better. Frank Shamrock joins us, dude, and he's got a lot to say. You know, we had Boss Rutan on a couple weeks ago, and he spoke about how marijuana in sports is a better go-to drug or prescription drug or whatever.
We got to come up with a better word because we say drug and I don't want to offend them.
Yeah, and I don't want to say marijuana either because marijuana still has a bad...
Earth's greenery.
The grass.
the grass.
Nature, Mother Nature. but he has a whole thing. You know, he works for a whole program basically for the advocate, not advertising, but promoting of marijuana in sports and just how good it can be for not just people with, you know, that are sick with cancer, but athletes and just people with everyday life.
All right. You don't got to make the case for him. He does plenty of that.
He does a very good job.
Mr. Shamrock, the great.
So he's on after that. So again, it is Francis Ngannou, followed by Jimmy Smith, followed by Frank Shamrock. But let's talk about UFC 209.
The headliner. What the hell? I had it a draw. Everybody's talking about Wonderboy Woodley. What the hell's going on? They don't want to see a trilogy. They needed a winner. Woodley, in the last 30 seconds, barraged Wonderboy, knocked him down twice. Wonderboy outpointed him, cage control.
Yeah.
I had it a tie. People don't want to see it again. How'd you score it? What'd you think? Who you know?
All right,
we both picked Wonderboy.
So, I mean, you could break it down so many different ways. I'll put it the way that I think it went, my opinion. I know that Woodley won the third and fifth round. That's not a question.
Yeah, that was the third that one that scraped him. Like, all of a sudden, they're like, I think there's bleeding under Thompson.
Yeah.
And he just touched him, and he starts gushing blood. Woodley's got big-time power.
Actually, to be honest with you, that might have been the second round. I can't remember which round that was in. But that might be why they gave Woodley the second round, because I didn't see it, dude. I saw Woodley the third and fifth, no question. Woodley was on top, had control in the third round. And the fifth, he clocked him at the very end. Never did I see a 10-8 round. I'm sorry.
Ooh.
I never saw a 10-8 round.
Well, how do you justify? People say, is it like two takedowns and you hold them down forever, or is it two knockdowns?
Pure domination of a round. I saw pure domination for 30 seconds.
Under that definition, then no. then right. You're right.
That's my opinion.
See, I go by ass hits the ground, you're wobbling, close to losing the fight. That's a 10-8. I like, wow. You make a good point, great point with the you have to dominate all assets of the round to give the 10-8. I mean, they said they're going to be more liberal about throwing
these
around.
They did.
So my tie scenario, I would make it a 10-8, but you make a great point that he didn't dominate.
So either way, I'm giving Woodley two rounds. I'm giving him third and five. I just, with the first, the second, and the fourth, and this is where I'm even fighting myself on this. I don't see where Woodley won the round. What, first, second, and fourth, I don't see it.
No shot.
Now, on the other hand, too, you could say, well, where did he lose it?
Great point. Because, dude, I, you know, that's why I'm like, you know what, Woodley, you take the title because you landed the more heavier punches.
Right.
Because Wonderboy told us in studio, and I believed him because he's Wonderboy. I believed him. And then all of a sudden he comes out hesitant again. And I'm like, come on, dude.
Well, here's the thing is, I've had this conversation with you about Dominic Cruz, TJ Dillashaw fight. Now, Cruz lost the belt prior just due to injury, so that's why he didn't have the belt, and that's mm-hmm. why Dillashaw ended up having it. So when Dillashaw lost to Cruz, I was like, oh, Dillashaw didn't really lose that fight. I don't know if Cruz won it, but Dillashaw didn't really lose that fight, and you should, in order to lose the belt, you should lose the fight. And they gave it to Cruz, and I guess you could give it either way, because Cruz never really lost the belt either. This fight, you look at it, and you say, Thompson might have stolen rounds, but never really
said
won
Thomason.
The fight. Tomlinson. Thompson. I'm thinking of football. Thompson may have not lost the fight, but he never really won any. He never didn't do enough to deserve the belt. And
you're
here's
right.
What it comes down to. This is my. People say it was the most boring fight ever. I don't think it was the most boring.
Take it easy, people.
People were real frustrated. This is not what we expected. And listen, Dana wasn't happy again with the final fight, the headliner fight, because the rest of the fights are fantastic. We'll talk about that in a second. But what it comes down to with Wonderboy and Woodley, both respected each other so much and were waiting for the other to throw a punch or to throw a kick so they can counter. That's what they both were game planning, and neither did the entire fight.
Dude, I 100% agree. I think there was respect, you know, some mutual respect going into 205, but this just showed it. Dude, it was like two guys holding their hand on the trigger in the old school saloon duel, and nobody wanted to pull the trigger. And see, I have no problem with this specifically because this division, nobody's pushing them out.
Right.
These two are above and beyond. Yes, St. Pierre's back. You know, who knows what St. Pierre
maybe
we're gonna
Lawler
get.
Comes back, but who knows?
But not in these two class. You know, like, yes, there's Maya. Yes, there's Lawler. Yes, there's Cerrone. But they're not these two skilled, well-rounded fighters.
Right.
I have no problem running back a third time. Don't make it a main event. Make Jones or Cormier, winner of Rumble, Cormier as the main event, or do it on FS1 or Fox. You know, people say, oh, I don't want to see that again. You would see it again if it was free. And couple of people are like, yeah, I guess I'd watch it again if it was free.
And listen, if you were like me and watching it, I expected there to be a little bit more punching and striking going on. I did. But it took to the last minute of the last round to get to that point, and look what freaking happened.
That exemplified how safe they were going.
Yeah, Woodley cracked him and almost finished the fight, and that's the reason why it got to that point, people. It was, they both knew what they were looking for, and they were just both very cautious because they knew, they both, listen, I've watched Wonder Boy's fights. We all know that his kicks are so good, so precise, and they come from all different angles. He hides them so well.
He made an adjustment that you told him to. He didn't throw weak takedown kick.
Not one. Which is partially why Woodley was like, why can't I take this guy down? What am I doing? There was no check kicks. There was no, let me just push him away. Let me just feel where the distance is. There was none of that. It was, if I'm going to strike, I'm going to strike high, and I'm going to strike hard. And it didn't happen as often as we wanted. But, there was a lot of anticipation.
Yeah, and it's fun for me. And Cruz got on, he goes, folks, this is when two fighters respect each other. It's a chess match. And I learned a lot of stuff from Cruz.
Dude, Cruz was fantastic.
He explained it so nicely. He goes, so Wonderboy cut off the cage and had Woodley cornered. And he goes, Woodley, now there's no further that Wonderboy could go. So he's literally waiting for Woodley to jump off the cage to respond, and then he would counter. And they were literally just sitting there against the cage looking at each other. And it was like, it was fun to like see, because we're deep into it, and it just pisses me off when I got to fight these reporters or dumb fans who are like, what is this? It's boring.
Yeah, giving boos all night and stuff like that.
It wasn't a Silva lackluster. It was two highly skilled, in their prime guys respecting each other. That's all it was.
Dana hated every second of it. He goes,
Because he's got to answer all the questions. I feel for him at times.
He came on and said, he's like, I built this fight up so much. How could, after watching the first five rounds, how could this fight be any less? And he goes, the difference between 10 rounds, it was outrageous. And it was. It was
10 rounds, yeah.
But you want to know what, man? You want to know what? I would definitely see it a third time. I no question would. Woodley definitely is a champion. That's not even debatable. Yeah. I was a little disappointed with Wonderboy, how he seemed a little deflated at the end of the night. He seemed very deflated, thought he did enough to win, and was kind of like, I need some time off. I need to, I got hit a couple times pretty hard the last couple months. So he's almost like, let me take some time off from this. I want to see him get back in it,
And it would be fun to see Wonderboy Lawler, I guess. But who knows what type of timetable Lawler is. Do you want to see the Maya Woodley?
No.
Because everybody, now they're saying, get Maya in there. I'm like, all right, guys, when that fight actually happens, it's either going to be like a wrestling match with some ground and pound, or Woodley just knocks him out in 10 seconds.
Right, you're gonna have, it's one or the other. There's no option. It's going to be and listen, Woodley, again, knows the wrestling a little bit, but Damian Maya is such a good fighter on the ground, and that's what he does. He finagles you into getting you on the ground, and you're tapped within about a minute and a half.
Like a Jacare, but without the punching power.
Without the punching power. So, yeah, I mean, is that going to be exciting?
That's not a headliner.
No, listen, Jacare versus Bosch, we were excited because, that's basically the matchup you have is Bosch could have knocked out Jacare. Jacare figured him out, got him to the ground, that was it.
Exactly.
That's the fight you're looking at, folks. That's the fight. Woodley has one or two opportunities to tag Maya. If he can't, then expect it to go on the ground and Maya to be the winner. And you're going to say, like, oh, man, I wish there was Woodley Wonderboy 3. That's what you're going to say.
Because in 5 years, you look back and you're going to say, what did these guys do in their prime? And we still have no clear winner from these guys fighting 10 rounds.
That's the main thing, dude. That's the main thing is they're both.
There's no playbook to the matchmaking.
No. And I don't want to say they're evenly matched because they're evenly matched in their skill set. But when they go head-to-head, it is a chess match, and you just don't know what's coming. And they played this one very close to the vest. And extremely close to the vest, where neither wanted to throw a punch, and we're waiting. And this is the Mayweather routine. I'm going to counter you, but you can't counter someone that doesn't throw.
See, that's a great point because everybody says boxing dead. I think if you're a boxing fan, you love boxing no matter what, and you like to counter the chess game. Maybe we're seeing the first inclination of fighters being so well rounded. Wonderboy learning grappling, Woodley learning striking. That maybe it is just an inch here, an inch there. Dana, either throw more incentive. You got to put a fire under these guys' ass. I don't know. What do you want me to say? I enjoyed it. It was a strategy. I wanted to run it back. I don't want to see my...
The one thing I did get nervous about, by the way, was Wonderboy.
And you don't get nervous.
No.
You really don't.
I don't. But Wonderboy was getting real close to Woodley and throwing those right hooks.
He's going to take those patty cakes.
Like, what were you doing? Like, no, like, don't waste your time. Like, I understand that you've been building up your conditioning, you're building up your strength, but don't do that because your reach is in your legs. Get that reach, get that distance. Don't go for the jibs because he'll clock you, and he did once.
Dude, I was waiting to see the next level karate that he's been telling us. And I understand you're scared of that right. It was so evident, and then all of a sudden Woodley just leaps 8 feet and can clock you.
Dude, he's
good.
So
I understand, but... Throw it on a free card. I put it on a pay per view. I'll see it as a co-main. I'll even see it as a main event. We're purists of the sport, but somebody who doesn't hesitate.
Oh no,
who does throw?
Francis Ngannou, who is in studio with us. Again, thank you very much to UFC for having him come in. The number six ranked heavyweight. This is the biggest guy that's walked in this door so far for us. Very intimidating.
Bigger than Boomer Esiason.
Yeah, very intimidating when you first see him. But guy is a very soft-spoken man. But damn, I can't wait to see him fight. And hopefully we see who he says he wants to fight next.
I want you, Pete.
No, not me. Never going to happen. Thank God.
Yes, Mr. Ngannou.
I'm so sorry. But he's coming up next on WFAN's Outside the Cage.
But first, which one's camera one?
You're camera one, you're camera two. Not really, but.
Dude, Habib.
I know.
Nurmagomedov. I feel like we don't have to remember it now for another 4 months. Tony Ferguson, little weight cutting problem. I think he said he only had to lose two the day of, and he was kind of bitter about that. But I'm bitter that Habib was about 7 pounds, 5 pounds at least over.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? Don't call Connor out and then don't make weight.
So I have a question for you, all right? Because this seems to happen a lot. And there's like this split down the middle where there's certain people that are advocates of, this is ridiculous. These fighters are killing themselves. You got to change the weight classes. You got to make it more like every 10 pounds there's a weight class because these fighters are destroying their bodies for this. On the other hand, there's people coming out. Fighters are speaking about this as well. You know, taking both sides. It's not just one or the other. They're taking both sides. Some fighters came out saying, we know the challenge. We know what we want to do. So that's on him. It's not on anybody else. He didn't need to cut 7 pounds in one day. That's what he left it
You're
to.
Right.
You know, he didn't do the proper cut the entire time. So we talked about how Wonderboy came in and he was looking to be a little bit heavier going into his fight versus Woodley. Khabib was obviously going in trying to be a little bit heavier. And obviously we know the positives with that is that you go in there, you have more punching power. The negative is that you drain yourself so much that you probably won't even have that power when you go in the cage. What is better for the UFC right now? What are they doing in this situation? Because it happens too much now. And I mean, we would have possibly got a catch weight fight, which would that still have been good?
It can't be for a title then.
No.
Because there's specific title weight, which I believe you can't be point, so it would be 155 and under. You can't be 155 and over. The 1 pound leeway, the 155.9, is for non-title fights. So Conor McGregor and
the Diaz,
they always say, like, I'm making title weight. They always do it like a mental thing. Like, I'm making you title weight no matter what. That's why I always like to ask these fighters what they walk around at.
Yeah.
And Francis, he's telling us he's walking around at his own weight. And that's just a byproduct of him caring, taking care of himself, having a nutritionist. So, Khabib, you knew this fight was coming. You know, you wanted to fight Tony last year. I mean, figure it out, my man. There's a lot of money at stake. There's nobody else to blame besides you and maybe your team.
It's just, it's a tough thing because you want to see the fight happen. You do. And Dana said that it could have been prevented. Not saying it could have been prevented 100%, but how he was treated, what his team did when they found out that he was having issues and when he was in distress and they took him to the hospital, that they didn't go to UFC. They kind of just went to like Sunrise Hospital, I guess he said, and he was just like, Dana said it was like one of the worst hospitals out there. So like, why would you do that? As soon as they said, oh, he's been trying to cut weight.
Desperation, I guess.
He's cutting weight and he's not doing well. So they automatically start pumping him with fluids. Now, what Dana said was the fight, not saying it would have been 100% to stay on, but if they would have gone through the proper precautions, went to his doctors, the UFC's doctors, they would have checked his vitals. They would have seen where he was at, seen if he was okay, and seen if that was a necessity to put fluids in there. But once you start pumping fluids in, fight's off. Because now you just defeated the entire purpose of him trying to cut weight.
That's exactly right, because Ian McCall, Uncle Creepy, who's had like 4 miss or canceled fights recently, he was on with Joe Rogan. He explained that exactly. He goes, he was so sick that he needed fluids, but he contacted the UFC like a professional, and he said, what do I do? They said, we're going to get fluids. He goes, but what if I can't fight? They said, no, you need fluids. But it turned out his opponent canceled, so he could have still fought under some weird loophole just to keep him surviving, you know?
Right.
But they say, Rogan was like, do you think they were trying to trick you, saying your fight is still on? And the fighter goes, oh, yeah, I'm still fighting, just to, like, save their life. Because the last thing they want is somebody dying from a weight cut.
Oh, my God, yeah, no, that would be miserable.
So what you were saying before, what they should do, I mean, just take care of yourself. That's it, off-season.
And do you think, though, but seriously, if you're breaking it down, is it more important to for fighters to push for these extended weight classes?
Yes, because it gives advantages. Wonderboy, if Wonderboy knows he could do it, then he could do it. John Jones walks around and he likes it. Connor likes it. He's bigger. You know, you're bigger in this post steroid UFC. You need every advantage you can get. So I was just saying, don't die.
Please don't die.
We saw Cyborg. You always bring up that video of her half dying. Don't put on so much muscle then. There's things that you could do.
You could just go, it's a lifestyle change, people. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. Yes. You don't have to be so gigantic. And I understand that the tactic is you want to keep that power on in the cage.
But you got to show up to the cage.
If you want that money, you got to get in there.
Right.
So that's really what it comes down to. And it sucks because Tony Ferguson was furious. You know, when he said the right things, being a nice guy. You know, he really did. He said, I wish him the best. He needs, you know, not to say, I don't think he said prayers, but I wish him the best right now because he's obviously in a state of, you know, discomfort, and I hope he gets healthy fast, which is very nice of him to say because he could have called
him. They fight again. I'm picking Ferguson just because of that mental edge now.
That's what I always talk about. Like, anybody that, this is what fight was it? The Pettis fight where, hey, you miss weight. He fought. And then he didn't perform that well. Is it already in his head? This, yeah. I think Khabib is not that type of guy. I think that, yeah, if he missed weight, I don't know how he would have been in the cage that night. But if he does fight again and he does make weight, I still think he's a badass. I really do.
And they're
really
trying to save these guys. They're putting the 10 a.m. Weigh-ins. You know, these guys could wake up at 8, do a little jog, lose a pound or half, do a towel sweat in the sauna. And you could – so when you see them at 4 – they're already probably 5 to 10 pounds heavier than the 10 a.m.
Yeah.
So they're trying, the UFC, they don't want nobody to die.
No.
You know, they're trying to make this as best as they can for their fighters. I don't want to see a weight class every 10 pounds.
What Khabib should do is rock that hat on his head when he weighs in normally. And if you think that you need to cut, just take it off, dude. That's what it is. That's your strategy. Just go forward with that. Always weigh in with that hat on your head so you know where you're at.
Disappointing. Yeah, the Muslim community, the Russian community,
and just
European
fight fans,
community.
Dude. Just fight fans. Dude. We were all excited for that fight. Listen, Wonderboy Woodley was excited, but this was getting amped up, and it was, it's tough for UFC to amp these guys up again because it's not the first time this has happened, and that's an issue, and that's something that they have to figure out going forward because whether it's injury, I joked, I was like, you know, when Khabib was going to the hospital, they were talking about it. He didn't show up for weight. I was like, is it kidney stones? If we get another Mitrione going on right now, and you joke and you try to make light of it. But in reality, it's like, damn, people spent, I'm sure UFC took a hit on paper, that pay-per-view card, no? And coming off a UFC 208.
Yeah, the whole Russian, if they even have pay-per-views out there,
why they were streaming it legally? What?
Order fight or turn off your water.
By the way, just to move on to some other things real quick, the rest of the card was really good. The Taymor fight was great.
Oh, man. That was fireworks.
I know, dude. And who would have known? Who would have thought that being fight before the main event was going to be such a... Dude...
And I think Dana knew. I'm telling you, there's that whole mafia. You wave the money around. Who's the cockfight and who's going to give me the best output? And those guys are young up-and-comers,
dude,
and they're in the co-main event
I looked at Taymor before fighting, and he had 700 followers on Twitter. I'm sure it's different now. But I'm like... And I watched him again, dude, another Ultimate Fighter guy. He was on the Conor McGregor Faber year.
Interesting.
Yeah, and he won the first round, and he lost the second round, but it was a good fight. But you saw something in him. But this fight was incredible. It was so good.
Rose to
the occasion. I was happy to see Rashad Evans get back in the cage.
Rashad, learn a jab.
He's just like, pa, pa, pa. I was happy to see him just get back in there. That was a win for us, I think. But what was the fight of the night for you?
It was the Lando David Taymor. That was the most entertaining. It got me up, hyped for the main event, and then all of a sudden the main event, you know, it kind of cooled off. Obviously, big strategy, but
right.
Definitely the co-main, man. I wonder how many punches and strikes. There was wheel kicks.
Oh, my God.
Counters.
It was great, dude.
Bloody mess. It was fun. You know, it was a nice lead into the main event.
Yeah, no question.
What about you?
But I do have to say this Bektik Elkins fight.
Oh, the comeback! The comeback!
Yeah.
Fight.
Oh my god, dude. Because I was okay. So I
great reference you made on Twitter.
Oh, with the Lieben?
Yeah.
Oh, yep. Dude, no, because as soon as you, there's so, some of these fights are so rare when it happens, and I was with Paul Rosenberg, who's a coworker of mine. He goes, I've never seen you react to a fight like that ever. And we've seen now every Saturday we work together, so he's seen me react to so many other fights. Like, oh, this is expected, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, kind of. That fight, how it ended, was such a shocker. I couldn't believe it. And he going into this fight, Rosenberg was talking about DraftKings. We have to talk about DraftKings on the show because I've never done fantasy MMA before, so I don't know anything about it. But he's asking me, who would you pick here? Who would you pick there? I go, well, who's the best ranked guy? They go, Mursad Bektik is the highest ranked guy. Like, he's got the most money behind him. Like, so it's clearly he's the favorite. He's going to knock him out.
Mm-hmm.
And it looked like that for 2.5 rounds that he was, I mean, he gave Elkins a cut that at the end of the first round, I go, you should probably end the fight here. Like, that's a huge gash on his right eye. Like, you should probably end the fight. How that fight finished was
amazing.
Utterly impossible. Fun. No one could predict that after watching the first round.
It showed from his reaction. It looked like he won the lottery, and he should. He kind of did win the lottery.
And where's it? What camp is he out of?
Ooh, I'm not sure.
Oh, I know.
Is it West
Alpha
Coast?
Alpha Male.
What do you know? What do you know? And that is, I'm trying to think. Buchholz, he talked about, because Cooper... Is excuse me.
No, not Cooper, but
Cavillo.
Cavillo, yeah.
She's out of Alpha Male too.
Yep.
I think he teased one of them being like a top prospect, Mr. Justin Buchholz.
You know, I saw him promoting both. I can't remember which one he did. All I know was that they were promoting Darren Elkins beforehand. The tattoo that he got. Did you see it?
No.
The damage. And someone from Team Alpha, like Team Alpha Male has a really good job with the tattoos, but someone should have talked to him before this. Because he was taking the damage for sure the first two rounds, but I mean that was an incredible.
The blood was covering the tattoo.
Thank God, dude, and it was unbelievable. I think the card overall was really good. I mean, the Alcantara Sanders fight was decent too. Like, you know, Sanders had the edge the whole first round. The second round he gets tapped randomly. It was just a really good night of fights, I think. And again, disappointed that Khabib was not on the card. That stunk. The main fight between Wonderboy and Woodley, maybe not as exciting as you wanted it to be, but it was still a great night for 209. Definitely a bounce back after 208.
Dude, the Conor curse looms. You know, their second biggest superstar, Ronda at 207,
yep,
falls out. Obviously, the main event at 206 before, like you said, with Pettis. And 208. 209, your lightweight interim title fighters who were fighting for Conor's title get pulled out. Conor's curse is looming.
Dude, they need him to get back in the cage quick. They need him to pump up.
This is helping him. He's just like, check, check, check. More money, more money.
More money, more problems, bro.
Dude, he needs 210. Cormier, you know Dana White's like, if they're like, yo, Daniel's knee's kind of fucked up, he's going to be like, I don't give a shit. Take that thing and get him in there.
Dude, yeah, like, put, like, just get a screwdriver, just, like, screw that thing together, dude. Dude, you cannot have anybody else back out of a fight. You need a good card with good fighters and everyone ready to fight. And listen, none of this weight cut nonsense. I don't know. I'm curious to see how Dana and UFC checks in on their fighters. If they do.
There you go. But that's how you fix it. You check in on Monday, check in on Thursday.
They may need to do like a checks and balances. That might be a thing. Dana, if you need help, I'm glad to give ideas. What? Ike too.
Thank you for joining us last week.
Yeah. Oh, dude. And it was a great interview.
What a huge week last week was, man.
It was, man.
It was fun. We talked to the the color commentator, Dominic Cruz, obviously the president. Habib, who I don't know if we warned him out and he just didn't want to, he was tired of talking to reporters.
I couldn't tell if he was just, you know, if that was just how he talks or if he, because he's a very like.
Off Karen, I can point to that. Pop in here.
Yeah, say hi to the cameras. We're filming right now. We're just about to wrap up. Good. Come in, say hi. Come on. Say hi to the cameras, everyone. Kara Ann. Did you watch the fights, Kara?
No.
That was a yes. She said yes. She watched the fight. She loved it. She specifically liked the Cooper Cavilla fight. So, But yeah, so dude, listen, it was good.
I thought you had no shoes on. I was like, it's freezing outside.
You no shoes, rocking the no shoes look. You're definitely a flip flop girl. I know that.
Yeah.
So it was a good weekend of fights, and we have another fight coming up this week.
What do we got?
Oh, Belfort versus Gastelum.
Vitor Gastelum. Yeah.
So that's Saturday, March 11th.
What do you got right now on the Tuesday, Wednesday?
Gastelum. All right. That's what I'm doing. Simple enough. Simple enough.
Hey, we got
Joe.
Mr.
Joe, come on in. We're filming too.
Turn the mic.
Sonny Liston, Lewiston, Maine, May 1965, if I'm not mistaken. I'll never forget it. The phantom punch, and Muhammad, of course, is standing over Sonny saying, get up and fight, get up and fight. They're going to say this isn't real if you don't get up and fight. So I'll never forget that moment. Great moment. That fight actually was supposed to be about 6 months earlier in Boston Garden, but they had to postpone it until later on, and it wound up being in Lewiston, Maine, of all places, because of the fact that Muhammad got a hernia. So they had to push that fight back. So that's why they wound up fighting in Lewiston, Maine.
So you're a big boxing guy?
Well, I was a huge Ali guy.
Ali guy.
Ali, one of my guys. Just like Clyde Frazier, just like Joe Namath, just like Tom Seaver, Ali was one of my guys.
Now,
I actually have that same picture down in my basement.
It's an original.
Yes, it is.
Would you ever like to watch an MMA fight?
No.
Why not?
The women.
The women.
That's it. And you give me that one woman, what's her name? Holt? Holly Holmes?
Holly Holmes.
She's not bad looking. She's okay. You know, and obviously Ronda Rousey's very attractive.
What about Misha?
So Misha, you had Misha on your show.
Yeah, isn't Misha the one that's kind of, not exactly.
No, she's good.
She's good? Okay. I don't really know her.
Yeah, no, Misha's
good. Misha's not listening now. You're going to come in and beat the, what out of
most people aren't listening.
You went
right
to the
now.
MMA?
A little bit.
All right.
Joe, what do you think?
Of who?
She was a former champion.
Excuse me. Yeah, hold on.
Guys, everybody, Joe Beningo, the great.
This is Misha?
Yeah, no, Misha.
Midday host with Evan Roberts.
You know what? Well, the other people, I mean, I don't know.
Come on. Right,
she's okay.
Okay. High standards.
But you prefer to watch. I don't want to get in trouble. I don't want to start,
That's
doing
okay.
Rating systems or anything like that.
Could they ever coach an NBA team, though?
What?
Could they ever coach an NBA team?
Hey, I think, why not?
Oh,
I'm all for
good.
I'm all for women. Hey, I'm a big for women coaching. I want a woman coach. I'm in.
That's what
talk.
You want to coach? Yes. You ready to coach the NBA
Let's
team?
Let's go.
Could you put up with these guys?
Yeah.
You think so? I don't know. I couldn't put up with them.
I could put up with them.
Maybe they might listen to.
Yeah. Because
you're a lot better looking than I am.
Thanks, Joe.
No way.
Thank
all
you,
right,
Joe.
Boy, all the love.
All the love, Joe. Thank you very much.
You're great.
Get a nice picture now of one of the Frazier fights, the Thriller in Manila. Get that one.
As long as they're on sale. As long as they're on sale.
Even the one he lost. By the way, it's interesting because tomorrow, March 8th is tomorrow. It is, let me see the exact number. It is the 46? Is it 46 years? March 8th, 1971. So what are we talking about? Yeah, 46 years ago, tomorrow was the greatest night in history of Madison Square Garden, the first Ali Frazier fight. When Joe Frazier actually beat Ali, that classic 15-round fight, I mean, it was unbelievable. What a night that was. One of the great, great nights in the history of Madison Square Garden. Tomorrow will be the anniversary, March 8th, 1971. Muhammad loses for the first time. Joe Frazier knocked him down in the 15th round. I mean,
where were you watching it?
I actually watched it in a movie theater in Paramus, New Jersey.
Get out of here.
It was a closed circuit, one of those deals. And most of the place was rooting for Frazier. I was rooting for Muhammad. And I remember leaving that fight actually in tears that Ali had finally lost. But it was one of the great fights of all time. I mean, a lot of fights that don't live up to the hype. You ever get a chance to watch that fight on tape? It is one of the great. I mean, I'm telling you, some of the shots that Joe Frazier took that night and just kept coming back, coming back, coming back. He was relentless that night. He was not going to lose to Ali. And it really was one of the great fights of all time. And I think the number one, forget the Knicks or Rangers or any of that, the circus, anything else that's gone on at the Garden, any of the concerts, the greatest night in the history of the Garden was March 8th, 1971, Ali Frazier won.
There you go.
Not all Sinatra?
Not even the main event with Frank. Not even that. My old, you know, I love Frank.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
we don't
yes.
want. I sing a little bit for you here, but I'm not going to do it. We don't have that kind of time. Next year's Christmas party, I'll sing
there
a little Frank.
Go.
Nice.
Thank you, Joe Bonego, everybody. Appreciate it. Thank you very much, Joe.
Folks, amazing.
Yes, that's how you do it. That's how you own a radio station, by the way. That's Joe Bonego right there. Joe and Evan, 10 to 1, Monday through Friday. On
our
WFN.
Second YouTube guest.
Yeah, of the day. Third. Well,
third. Geez. Grab the mic.
But listen, let's wrap it up because we've gone on too long. Thank you very much for watching, listening. Again, this is WFAN's Outside the Cage. Ike Feldman, Pete Hoffman, @_OutsideTheCage, @Ike_CBS.
At the Hoff WFAN.
We got WFAN.com. We got Play.it, iTunes. We have maybe CBSSports.com. We have YouTube.com. There we go. And we will see you guys next week.
Yeah, buddy. Yeah.